Well, thank you again for being here. As we kick off our second panel discussion, we're really here to, right now to talk about the use of the Army Reserves at home and abroad. And I couldn't ask for a better panel than the gentleman here sitting to my right. We're first going to turn to Lieutenant General Donahue, who is the Deputy Commanding General over at U.S. Army Forces Command. ForceCom is the Army's largest command and the generating conventional land forces provider for combatant commanders. So I don't think there is anyone better situated to talk about how the Army thinks about using the different components, regular, National Guard, and Reserve. Now, General Donahue graduated from West Point and was commissioned as an infantry officer in the regular Army back in 1980. I note that he was an Olmsted scholar, which is wonderful to see. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Olmsted program, but it is quite an honor to be sitting next to someone who has been through that program. And I understand, sir, that you were in Austria.
So ich habe Deutsch an der Universität studiert.
Excellent. For those who are not familiar with Olmsted, they actually have to complete coursework in the home country's native tongue. So his German sounds pretty good to me, for what it's worth. But I would also say he holds two masters, and one is from my alma mater, the Kennedy School, which it may not be an Olmsted scholar, but it's pretty good nonetheless at Harvard, and then a master's of strategic studies from the Army War College. And so I will turn to him first to talk a little bit about how ForceCom officials think about the total Army, the joint force, and what the Army Reserve role is within that. After General Donahue concludes his remarks, I will turn to Major General David Convoy, who assumed his responsibilities at U.S. Army Reserve Command as the Deputy Commanding General for Operations back in October of last year. In this capacity, he oversees the 16 Army Reserve operational and functional commands located here in the continental U.S., Hawaii, Puerto Rico, and also in Germany. And so I will turn to him. He also has a very excellent academic career. I can go into, I'm trying to find it in your bio, but I believe you're from the University of Buffalo?
University of Notre Dame undergrad, University of Buffalo grad.
So we have lots of degrees up here, but I believe you also are a certified project management professional and an engineer, which is outstanding to hear. And I initially referred to him as batting cleanup, but he preferred to have me say that we're saving the best for last, is our civilian on the panel, Deputy Assistant Secretary Bob Salises. Bob is the DASDE over at the Pentagon for Homeland Defense Integration and Defense Support of Civil Authorities. And I've often turned to Bob to talk me through how the Homeland Defense part of the Pentagon thinks about regular Army, National Guard, and Reserve. And earlier you heard Congressman Heck talk about the NAGRIA, and that is the National Guard and Reserve Equipment Account. And Bob is the only person I know who, when I went to his office to speak to him at that point about the National Guard, he actually brought out a copy of the NAGRIA that had dog ears and post-it notes and could walk me through exactly what was going on. And for a high-level policy official, I think there is no one better here in D.C. to talk about what the role of the Army Reserve is here at the home game. So without further ado, I'm going to turn to General Donahue. Sir.
Well, thank you very much. I did not get a degree from the University of Innsbruck because I had to pass a Latin exam, which I could not do. So honored to be here. And it's I'm the token active component member of this panel. And the reason why I'm here is because I have a very close relationship with the U.S. Army Reserve and the National Guard in my role as a Deputy Commander of the U.S. Army Forces Command. So I want to talk about that. So I have a very good view on how the USAR supports the nation at both home and abroad. The mission of the Forces Command, you know, we are responsible for from the Secretary for the training, sustaining, mobilizing, deploying, and reconstituting of all Army forces, all components. We also command all of the service-retained active component forces in CONUS. So that's 3 corps, 9 divisions, 88 brigades. And these are the forces that we use to partner with the Guard and Reserve. And now the chairman mentioned that in his comments and his questions, that one of the ways we're getting at integrating the total force is through a very deliberate exercise program and training program where all 3 components support each other. And we do that at Forces Command. We are the force provider for since the disestablishment of GFCOM, the Secretary of the Army gave us that mission, Forces Command, and that mission, we are the service force provider for Army conventional forces, and not including special forces. So that's for all three components. We also receive training readiness oversight of the reserve components from the Secretary of the Army when GFCOM disestablished. Now, we execute that execute that training readiness oversight through an executive agent, which is our first Army, led by Lieutenant General Tucker. That command has recently reorganized. It used to be focused on the post-mobilization aspects of what the Guard and Reserve did. And now it is changes focused through a process it calls bold shift. So it is now focusing on pre-mobilization to enhance the training of the U.S. Army Reserve and the Guard so that when they do report to a mob station, they spend less time there and they're more ready. So that's a major effort. This is really the first year that we're into that process, and I think it's already showing great benefits. Forces Command actually commands the U.S. Army Reserve Command headquarters. Now, General Talley, my good friend over there, he's responsible as the Chief of the Army Reserve for the actual pre-mob training and readiness of the U.S. Army Reserve forces. So it's an interesting and complex but very interwoven partnership we have with the reserves. The easy thing is that we share our building. So he comes every now and then, but Dave's always there. And so he's on the same floor as me. And so if we need to coordinate something, we just walk down the hall. It's very convenient, to coordinate actions, and we do that routinely. So the total force at home and abroad. We even heard it a little bit today about how, as the war ends, we have more time to do stuff. The Army, the total force remains very, very busy. We can't meet the COCOM command and requirements of serving nation as a single component. We have to use the total force. And just as a reminder, 45% of the combat strength in our Army is in the Guard, but 66% or more of our combat support and combat service support capabilities are in the U.S. Army Reserve. We're designed to fight as a total force. We cannot fight as a single component, and then we haven't in the last 15 years. Just to give you an idea of how busy we remain, for fiscal year 15, there are 316 USAR units that have been gift map ordered. That means the COCOM commanders generate a requirement and the SecDef has approved that particular force, 316 of them, to go into a support of a named operation, mainly in Afghanistan and Iraq. So the USAR remains very busy. And I want to highlight, we talked about it, and I think, I don't want to steal the thunder here, but we have 30 USAR units that have been gift map ordered to support NORTHCOM here in the continental United States. Defense support to civil authorities and the defense sovereignty response is a Title 10 mission, largely. And so that's why we have those USAR units supporting that mission and that NORTHCOM commander. Now, for fiscal year 16, as we already have 238 USAR units that have been ordered against COCOM requirements. So the demand is not abating. It's going. We anticipate it being just as high next year as it was this year, once we get all the orders through the SecDef into Forces Command. Now, one of the ways we manage, the USAR, we talked about it, has an operational and a strategic role. The operational role, we have a lot of early deployers that are USAR units. And how do we manage that? How do we possibly do that? We have a thing called the Army Contingency Force concept. It started off as something different, but now it has evolved to identifying all of the early deployers, active guard and reserve. And I think quarterly we look at that, and Chief Staff of the Army on down, we have one of our sessions where we review readiness is focused on the ACF. And so about one third of our Army Contingency Force is made up from USAR units. And, you know, how is that possible? These tend to be small units, but they're the key CSS units like port opening or medium truck companies, medical units that are only found in the reserve that we have to have early in any conflict. And so we manage them. We actually micromanage them. If they have some issue, if some company has some issue with equipment, that there's some shortfall, at the three-star level, we're making sure that reserve company gets that equipment so it meets its timelines for deployment. So it is a concept that works, and we're continuing to refine it to make it more valid, but it is a concept that we're using to make sure that the total force can respond to an unexpected conflict abroad. Okay, so we have lots of authorities for using the Army reserves in operations both home and abroad. Of course, you know, we had the big the strategic mission, you know, total MOB, which is called 12301 authority, which is what we use in World War II. That's available. So we talked about it somewhat. If you want to conduct a breach under fire, you got the active engineers and you got the guard engineers who can do that. We're with the combat engineers, the sappers. You want to build a bridge and pave it, and that bridge is, you know, spanning a major river. You go to the U.S. Army Reserve for that. That's the type of skill sets that are strategic in nature, but they have to be resident in our force because we will use them in a major conflict, and that is found in reserve. We talked about the medical units, all the docs, the lawyers, the chaplains, all that deep expertise is found in the U.S. Army Reserve, theater engineer command, civil affairs commands, legal support units, et cetera. In the operational role at home, we use various authorities. We use, strangely enough, 12304 Bravo authority to support NORTHCOM. And that is, you know, a authority that allows us to support a COCOM commander for a requirement, to meet a requirement that's been validated by the SECDEF. And we have, I'm pretty proud of this unit. It's the 76th Operational Response Command. It's in Salt Lake City, Utah, U.S. Army Reserve unit. It is meeting the requirements that was supposed to have been filled by an active duty division, which we did not have. So we've turned to U.S. Army Reserve, another Title 10 force, to fill that mission, and they came up with this force. And we used this 12304 Bravo authority to actually mobilize 10% of that unit, because that command has a 96-hour response capability. So with the full-time support it has, plus this 10% augmentation that we mobilized, it can have a standing core that allow it to meet this requirement, this recall requirement. Its primary mission, C2CRE, is command and control suburban response element. It's lots of acronyms, but it is the force that would respond to some nuclear, chemical, or radiological attack or disaster in the United States under the COCOM commander's authority. And we mentioned briefly, we have new authority since 2012 to respond to the natural disasters and emergencies here in the United States for the U.S. Army Reserve. It's called 12304 Alpha Authority. When the governor asks for support, the SECDEF can mobilize USAR units for 120 days to go and provide that support. And it was first tested and used in after Hurricane Sandy and for dewatering, you know, getting the water out of the subways and underpasses and things like that. The USAR units did that based on a request from the governor. So it has been tested, and it has been a proven capability that we have. So abroad, when we send units to CENTCOM, the chairman talked about it. We have a partial MOB authority, that's 12302 authority, and that comes with OCO, Overseas Contingency Operations Funding. So we do, you know, that is an easy one for us to meet when that particular unit is best, is found in the USAR and is the best suited to fit that requirement. It's easy to pick that USAR unit because it comes with the pay and allowance funding. Now, we do have a guard, a USAR mission in KFOR right now. So they just deployed the 30th Brigade, Armor Brigade out of North Carolina, has provided a nucleus for that particular K-4 mission. But I think there are 12 USAR units there as well. And we're using 12304 Bravo money. Now that money's different than the OCO money because it comes out of the base. And so that we have to program that at Forces Command, and then and we have to fight in the POM to get it to get that money funded. And in the year of execution, normally something will happen we didn't anticipate. There's more requirements for that type of money, so it's a zero-sum game. The Army will find it, like they, in this case, and for 15 and in 16, they found the money despite it being tight to pay for the pay and allowances to allow the that mission, which is not OCO supported, but that for that mission to be met by a reserve component solution. Another thing we do, we issue a thing called, an Forces Command called a Mission Alignment Order. And so we've taken every unit in the Army that we are in charge of and aligned it to a combatant command. And this is, we kind of stole this from the National Guard SPP. And so we saw the benefit of having sustained relationships between Guard states and a particular country. So now we're applying that to the USAR in this case. As well, like the 353 Civil Affairs Command out of in New York, it's been aligned to Europe and Africa, and so in that order. So now the two ASCC commanders, the one in Germany and the one in Italy, can turn to that command and know they have a dependable source of meeting civil affairs requirements in either Africa or Europe. And that source is familiar now with Africa. And when I was there, the commander of U.S. Army Africa, I started this. And since I left, that 353 has done 8 different missions, mainly water-related missions, leveraging the public-private partnership expertise that the USAR brings in Africa, and there's plenty more coming. The Third Medical Command similarly supports Africa, and we have lots of missions coming out of them as well, building African medical capacity in a sustained manner. We can count on them over years to be in that area. I'll talk about other things too in questions and answers, but. The one thing we didn't really talk about, but the USAR also supports the Army as an institution. Like this summer, we have 2,000 drill sergeants supporting the TRADOC out of the U.S. Army Reserve. We couldn't do it. The big summer surge, whenever all the kids graduate from high school, they come, and this is when we need the drill sergeants, and we don't need them in October, November. We need them in June, July, August, September, and that's when the USAR comes in and helps us out. We couldn't do it without them. And then, so I just want to close by saying, we cannot serve our nation without having a total force approach to meeting those requirements. There is no way the active or the guard or reserve alone can do it. The active can provide the prompt response, but the reserve components, in particular the USAR in this case, provides that sustained response. We can't, the active force does not have the depth to do it alone. And that's not how we're designed. We're designed intentionally to fight as a total force. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Stephanie. I appreciate the opportunity to be here and talk a little bit about the Army Reserve and the value that we bring to both the Army and the nation. I appreciate the previous panel's discussion. I, too, am a citizen soldier. Although I'm currently activated as a USARC DCG, for most of my career in the Army Reserve, I've had two jobs, one with the Army Corps of Engineers as a civilian, where I've got the professional management certifications and an engineer degree, but then also serving as a Army Reserve officer. So I think the previous panel members really did a great job of articulating why that provides great benefit to both the Army and the nation. On the military side, but also to our employers, and so I appreciate their great work on the panel. So I'd like to start by focusing a little bit about the basics of the Army Reserve. Some of it's been covered before, so I'll try to highlight a few things that haven't been covered and emphasize a few others, but we are the Army's Title 10 Reserve Force. So we're designed and authorized to provide trained and ready soldier, leader, and units that that are prepared to support the Army and the Joint Force, both at home and abroad. And as was mentioned earlier, we're a great value for the Army in that we provide 20% of the Army force for just 6% of the budget. We're currently, this year, we have a congressionally authorized end strength of 202,000 soldiers. That's the largest three-star command in the Army. It's also larger than the active duty Marine Corps, so General Talley has a significant responsibility. We do exist to provide the Army and the nation with cost-effective, ready and resilient and accessible Army Reserve soldiers that provide that life-saving and life-sustaining capacity that was talked about previously. Since 9/11, we have mobilized over 300,000 Army Reserve soldiers to support contingency operations around the world. And today, we have over 15,000 Army Reserve soldiers that are currently engaged working with Army Service Component Commands and COCOMs throughout the world, not only in CENTCOM, but USER, PACOM, SOUTHCOM, NORTHCOM, and the other combatant commands. So highly engaged in activities throughout the world. As General Donahue just pointed out, we're also engaged in the homeland. We have 24,000 soldiers that are supporting the Training and Doctrine Command, that's supporting our schoolhouses, and also the 2,000 drill sergeants that General Donahue mentioned. And that also includes support that we provide to First Army that he also mentioned. That significant part of their force is Army Reserve soldiers that are helping not only to train and prepare for mobilization Army Reserve forces, but also National Guard forces. A key component, again, of the Army Reserve is that we are the federal force. We're accessible to the Army, to the nation, 24/7. And we're both a component of the Army, COMPO 3, and also a command, as was touched on a little bit before. So General Talley, my boss, has two hats. As Chief of the Army Reserve, head of the component, he reports to the Chief of Staff of the Army, General Odierno, and the Secretary of the Army. And then also as the head of the command, he reports to the ForceCom commander. And so there's a lot of power in that being the head of the command and being an actual commander of those 202,000 soldiers, he can rapidly execute missions that are called upon by the combatant commands to meet an immediate need. Just a recent example, when there was the earthquake in Nepal, General Brooks, the USERPAC commander, called General Talley and needed very quickly some civil affairs soldiers to deploy to support that response effort. And without going to the Pentagon, without doing anything that needed outside of command authority, General Talley was able to get those folks on the ground very quickly. And there's other numerous examples of how being both a component and a command have been very, very beneficial to the Army and to the nation. With the majority of the sustainment forces that have been talked about, we're absolutely critical to the Army, to the nation, and really to the Joint Force in terms of theater opening and also to conduct sustained operations. We have 77% of the Army civil affairs capacity resident in the Army Reserve. We have 66% of the quartermaster units, 59% of the deployable medical units that General DeZicke talked about, and really all of the theater level engineer, MP, and signal capability to support contingency efforts around the world. And so we really cannot conduct sustained operations in the military without the Army Reserve. We provide these capabilities to the combatant commands through a number of different sources. We provide Army Reserve engagement cells that General Talley established to the Army Service Component Commands and Army Reserve engagement teams to the combatant commanders. So those are full-time Army Reserve soldiers paid for by General Talley that are the one door to the Corps, one door to the U.S. Army Reserve Command in terms of providing capabilities, whether it's looking at contingency planning, looking at kinetic operations, theater shaping requirements, or also, importantly, working to identify funding sources that might be available, something General Donahue was very proficient at in U.S. Army Africa, looking at how do we use not only Army Reserve money, but Army money, other partners, and perhaps even other partner nations to accomplish the mission. So that's a way that we're engaged not only through the regional alliance forces that General Donahue mentioned, but really providing access to all 202,000 soldiers in the Army Reserves to the combatant commanders based on their needs and their requirement. Let me talk briefly about the Army Reserve support to the homeland. It was mentioned we are resident in 1,100 communities throughout the nation, so we are perfectly positioned with our life-saving and life-sustaining forces to provide that response if we have a natural or national disaster in the homeland. So every commander in the Army Reserve, every commander in the Army, in the military, has immediate response authority. So with the assets that are available to any commander in the Army Reserve throughout the country, they can respond to a request for an assistance from a local or state official based on the assets they have over 72 hours. So that's an important thing to note. It's something that we're working to educate the communities about that assets that are available to them. General Donahue mentioned the DSERF and the C2CRE mission. You know, only the Army will come up with an acronym that has acronyms within it. So the DSERF, the Defense Suburban Response Force, C2CRE being the Command and Control Suburban Response Element. As he mentioned, we lead the C2CRE Alpha element, but of the 5,200 Army soldiers that are resident in those three different units, nearly half of them are Army Reserve soldiers, and we're the only component that has capacity and forces in each of the three elements, and we lead one of those. So it's an absolutely critical mission, and it's a mission that we're very well suited for. And then integrating the capabilities of our forces is important, and we do that through what's called EPLOs, Emergency Preparedness Liaison Officers, and we provide in the Army Reserve 100% of the 177 EPLOs that the Army has, and almost 50% of the DoD EPLOs. So those EPLOs are the critical link to not only Army forces, but other joint forces, interagency, local and state responders. So as another example, during a Superstorm Sandy, I had to say that slowly, Superstorm Sandy, General Talley deployed 25 EPLOs to support that mission, and they were absolutely critical to synchronizing the work that was done to ensure that the response is as efficient as possible, because at the end of the day, you know, our citizens expect all components of the military, all components of our government to work together regardless of where they're coming from to provide the resources that accomplish the mission. So lastly, to encourage some discussion, let me just talk a little bit about more about the operational reserve. We have been an operational reserve for the last 14 years of war. In the future, we will probably not be able to be as operationally ready as we have been in the past, so there will be a component of the reserve that's going to have to be strategic, but we absolutely have to maintain that operational capacity that we have in a portion of our force, and we do that through the plan, prepare, provide model that General Talley has put in place that provides progressive readiness that ensures that we're as ready as possible all the time, but when a unit is entering into their available year, they have the resources, they have the training dollars, and they have the equipment to ensure that they're able to accomplish the mission. Because if you look at, I know this is not a classified setting, but I know if you look at our con plans and our op plans where Army Reserve assets are required, they're required early and often in those con plans. So we absolutely have to make sure that we maintain that operational reserve to meet mission requirements. And then the other piece to that is, you know, looking at our force and sustaining our force, our soldiers have joined the Army Reserve after 9/11. They joined to be a part of something bigger than themselves and to be a part of something that is away from the homeland and is providing great service to our nation. So we do not want to collapse to a strategic force that is simply sitting in the drill hall looking at PowerPoint presentations and talking about what happened in the last war. So first and foremost, obviously, operational reserve to maintain readiness and mission accomplishment, but also to ensure we're taking care of our soldiers. And in the end, when the president calls, whether we're ready or not, whether we've been resourced or not, we're going to go and we're going to do our best to accomplish that mission. And we're going to end up, if we don't resource now, paying for that in terms of the blood, sweat, and tears of our soldiers. And we absolutely don't want to do that. So we think it's critical to maintain the operational reserve to ensure that the Army and to ensure that the nation can complete our mission. So just talk briefly about couple of other topics. The family readiness piece was touched on, is very important. General Talley implemented something called Fort Family, which is a one-stop shop, recognizing that Army Reserve soldiers aren't on installation, so for any issue that an Army Reserve soldier has, they can contact Fort Family, and whether it's some sort of confidential counseling, if it's family readiness issue, if it's an employment issue through P3, we can ensure we get them the right assets, and that's absolutely critical. And then we're working hard to make sure that as we transition soldiers off of active duty, that we provide a place for them in the Army Reserve, and we're working hard. General Talley has placed at every installation, active duty installation, Army Reserve transition counselors. So to amplify what Representative Heck was saying, we are engaged, working very hard to ensure that we're taking those soldiers that are on active duty and giving them a home in the Army Reserve. It helps our readiness. It's good for our nation. We don't have to train folks over. And so just wanted to touch on that quickly. And again, appreciate the opportunity to be a part of the panel and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Stephanie, thank you and for having us, and thanks to CIS for hosting this. It's an honor to be here with Lieutenant General Donahue, Major Convoy, Lieutenant General Talley. It's a pleasure to see you. And one of my old bosses, Mr. Todd Rosenblum, is here. We still talk, so that's a good thing. It's important. It's good to be here. But as Stephanie said, I'm going to focus on domestic support, if I could, for a minute. So let me start with this. The American people can benefit greatly from an expanded role of the U.S. Army Reserve in defense support to civil authorities, affectionately known in the Department of Defense as DISCA. You've heard a lot this morning, but I believe the U.S. Army is ideally suited to serve our nation to support domestic missions, in particular in DISCA. Let me just start with what DISCA is, and it's really three main elements when we look at defense support to civil authorities in the Defense Department. It's supporting law enforcement, as we do down in the southwest border, and I know the Army Reserve has played a role in that. It's also public health emergencies, which, as we all know from the Army Reserve makeup, can be very, very helpful. And if you look at what happened with Ebola, the MERS outbreak, and the other kinds of infectious disease that we see around the world, it's tremendously helpful to have that medical capability available for public health emergencies. And then support to disasters. We all understand how unique the Army Reserve is, and as many have said before me in the panels here, but I believe the citizen soldier capability that the Army Reserve brings to the DISCA mission because of their proficiency in civil affairs, medical support, engineering, and a host of other critical missions that they have the capabilities to support. And if you understand the national response system and the national response framework, there's these things called ESFs, emergency support functions. They're headed up by federal departments and agencies. And if you look across all 14 of them, ESF1, headed up by the Department of Transportation, Health and Human Services, the medical, DOE, energy. If you begin to look at those ESFs, the corresponding capabilities and skills that are in the Army Reserve fit very nicely with all of those. And there's tremendous capability in the Army Reserve that I believe could be better used in the future in these missions. We went through, I know all the percentages, so I'm not going to go through that, but I can tell you, being a former Marine, a logistician, and spending over a decade in emergency response, when you look at this book and you look at the capabilities around the nation and how they're arrayed within the communities, it's extraordinary. It's really extraordinary what's available out there. And I understand the motto, twice the citizen, is what the Army Reserve uses. And it's really important to recognize how influential twice the citizen is, both in their military duty and the communities, serving in all 50 states and the territories. This strong connection is vital during defense support to civil authority missions, especially in disaster response. So I think that these soldiers in the Army Reserve, with their civilian work experience, their tremendous capabilities, their strong connections to the communities, and their geographic proximity should be leveraged to respond to requests of civil authorities. They can quickly bring enormous amount of capability, specialized skills, to nearly every zip code in the United States. Now, let me just say, defense support to civil authorities is a total force mission of the Defense Department. And in my opinion, the department, the Army, and the Army Reserve benefit greatly from participating in defense support to civil authorities missions. When we talk about DISCA, we usually focus, and rightfully so, on what DOD can do for others to help. But I also believe that performing DISCA missions can also help DOD and the military. DISCA support, in my view, can actually increase soldier, leader, and unit readiness. It allows service members to gain proficiency in their mission essential tasks. And when you look at the Army Reserve and the capability sets that they use, this is, I think, particularly true. But it also hones military operational skills like responding to humanitarian disasters, evacuation operations, and the work that we do in interagency operations. It also, in my opinion, provides real world opportunity for multi-component operations, which I know is very important to the Army as a whole. DISCA training and operations hone a very unique skill that military members need, whether it's domestic or overseas, and that's our ability to communicate. Communicate in civil society and understanding the role of civil authorities. Having the benefit of operating in a DISCA environment hones these types of skills. It allows military members to become more effective in that. DISCA also provides a unique opportunity for the military, and in particular, the Army Reserve, to work closely with civil society. It increases the interaction, the strengths, and the bonds between the community, the military, and fosters a sense of neighbor helping neighbor. It also, in my opinion, has the potential to enhance recruiting and retention, which I know as a former Marine, spending time on recruiting, that's a tough job, and it's always good to have a connection in that regard. So we've made a lot of good efforts, in my opinion, in advancing the Army's role in defense support to civil authorities. In particular, I'd like to thank the Congress for enabling us through this process. They were very supportive. In 2012, as General Donahue mentioned, legislation was passed, 12304 Alpha, to provide the reserve component access authority. It's the authority for involuntary mobilization of the reserve component, which certainly is important and has been very helpful. And as General Donahue mentioned, also, the support that was provided in Superstorm Sandy. The quartermaster units that went up there did tremendous work, and it was a great opportunity. I think that's a very, very important ability for the Army Reserve and the other reserve components of the Defense Department. However, in my view, many DISCA operations are of the scope and scale that are below the threshold of involuntary mobilization. But they're still very important and require some level of federal response, especially when the speed of response is critical to saving lives. This is where I believe using volunteers, 12301 Delta, combined with our immediate response authority, enables the U.S. Army Reserve volunteers to assist their communities, the National Guard, and lead federal agencies. It can provide a host of critical capabilities immediately to our communities around the nation. Most recently, in May when Typhoon Dolphin hit Guam. The Army Reserve units out there volunteered to help out and did tremendous work. So, in my opinion, having the U.S. Army Reserve, have volunteer unit arrangements and providing access to the Army Reserve in our communities can speed some of the most needed capabilities to our citizens in their greatest time of need. So let me pull the string on that a little bit. I believe there's some steps that we can take to make the Army Reserve even more effective in this area, the volunteer effort. By working together, we can posture ourselves to be even more prepared. So some of the things I believe we can do is having volunteer agreements with our soldiers at the unit level. This would identify a cadre of service members wanting and ready to assist. It also would ensure that any of those U.S. Army Reserve soldiers that are first responders are not double-tapped in some ways. I also believe that working with local community planners, we can more effectively identify the gaps in the communities, and they have a better understanding of what the Army Reserve can provide with their capabilities. I think we should look at updating mutual aid agreements within those communities where there's the Army Reserve. I think we should look at exercising with those community partners, the local government, the National Guard, volunteer organizations. And I think we should continue on this journey in the volunteer 12301 Delta, because I think it offers a unique opportunity to the Army Reserve, and I believe it also offers a tremendous opportunity to the communities within our nation. So finding these opportunities of the untapped potential of the Army Reserve and involving the Army Reserve in DISCA planning and operations provides that benefit that our nation, I believe, could experience through more of the volunteer work. So thank you. I look forward to any questions.
All right. Thanks to all of you. Before I open the floor to questions, I would like to highlight something that General Convoy said, which was, General Brooks out at USERPAC had identified a need for civil affairs officers after the Nepal earthquake. And I'm just curious, General Donahue, when U.S. Army Forces Command thinks about providing forces based on a geographic combatant commander request, how do you then turn to the Army Reserve to fill that requirement versus other elements of the Army?
Well, I'm glad you asked. It's an elaborate process, honestly. It has four steps. I anticipated this question. So the first thing we do is we evaluate what's out there, what's in the inventory. If they're asking for a medium truck company, there's only one place we can go. It's not in the active. Okay, and then the next thing we look at is what statutes and authorities are available. Like when West Africa happened, we couldn't use the existing authorities. There was before the president authorized mobilization of the reserve components for that mission. So the initial response was only active because I did not have a reserve option to turn to because I did not have the authority for that mission yet. But like in this, Afghanistan, Iraq is easy. We have the authority, the partial MOB, and it's easier. In other places, like for a named operation, like in Mali or in Kosovo or something, it's much more difficult because I get the authority with the 12-34 Bravo, but I also have to make sure I have the money. So we have to work through all that. Okay, so we work through that, and then we look at the actual unit. Is it ready? And when we evaluated what units went to West Africa, we actually pulled out the USR reports, the status reports, and read them. You know, say, okay, this unit says it's, you know, has commanders in place. They've done some training this summer. Okay, they're good. Even though they're C3, we're going to send them because this mission doesn't require them to be fully ready for their combat mission. This is perfect. So we went down the list. We actually used that. So hopefully those commanders paid attention, because we actually read them. And then the last thing we look at is and this is very important, this is the deployment to dwell and the mob to dwell. You know, the goal is 1-2 for the active, and the red line is 1-1. We have many active units that are pushing 1-1 still. And we have a lot of reserve units that are also being tapped more often than the 1-5 goal. So we look at that. So at the end of it, if we have the authority to use reserve component unit, we have they're trained and ready reasonably enough for a short notice requirement. And the dwell issue is resolved. There's not, it allows us to go that way. We'll go with a reserve unit. And using West Africa as an example, we could not use the first tranche. We could not use the reserve or the guard in the first tranche, but the second tranche was almost all reserve and guard. And that was turned off. Because when we first came up with the mission, we thought it was going to be, it was a mission to save humanity at one point. And then because of our support to civil authorities, the IOs and NGOs, it was contained, and we could turn the mission off. So it is an elaborate process. It is fully informed. Like, I don't pick a U.S. Army Reserve. I don't pick like the 377th TSC or something. I will say, we think there's a solution in reserve after going through all that. And we'll turn to General Talley and his crew and say, and then they'll confirm that mission is suitable for that particular unit. And with the guard, the same thing. We think there's a capability in the guard, and we'll send it to the Guard Bureau, and they'll come back with the unit. May not be the same one we're thinking of, but they come back with a unit to meet that requirement. Make sense?
It does.
I would like now to open up to the audience for questions. As the rule was earlier, it's still the same. Please wait to be identified, stand, wait for a microphone, introduce yourself and your affiliation, and ask a question. I appreciate it. Gentlemen up front, please.
So I am Dr. Dishar Chaudhary with Pakistan American League. We contribute in the area of U.S.-Pakistan enduring relations and regional security issues. It's a question for General Donahue. Before start of the panel, he mentioned about he had been to Afghanistan. I just wanted to know, when the Army moved to Afghanistan, how much did they know about Afghanistan? And when they are leaving, how much more they know about Afghanistan? And in your experience as observations, what are the lessons learned? And if you have to advise the Chairman, Joint Chief of Staff, what advice or recommendations you will give him? Thank you.
Well, thanks for asking that question. I was one of the first. I was in Iraq when we invaded. I left Baghdad in June. I took middle of June, and I took, correction, middle of July. And 2 weeks later, I took command of my brigade in Kandahar. So I knew literally nothing about Afghanistan. But what I could read on the C-17 when I was flying from Iraq to Afghanistan. And I had to learn quickly, though, and I think the lesson learned, this is why we think that the RAF idea, the regionally aligned force idea, is so important. We can't go into a country, into a region, into anywhere without knowing something about the context of the environment we're entering. By staying engaged, like the special forces do, we can learn, we can develop relationships, we can basically set the theater so that we understand the context of what it is that's happening in the country that we'll have to operate in potentially. Because it was not we worked really hard, did a lot of great things, but looking back, at that time in 2003, it was not nearly as effective as it should have been, because I did not, as a brigade commander, understand the context in which I was operating. I did not know about Peshtawali, I didn't understand the dynamics between Pakistan and Afghanistan. I learned all that. Now, I got to go back again for another deployment as brigade commander, and I had a completely different understanding of the situation then. And that's when I had really good relationships with all the PAC brigadiers along the border. And I would go visit them in Miram Shah or Khyber, the Khyber Rifles mess, I mentioned that. And so I was a much more effective brigade commander because I knew the context in which I was operating. And that's what we hope to do. That's the lesson learned. We hoped to be able to sustain by the regional aligned forces concept that the Army is working. Thank you for the question.
Turn to this gentleman up here, and then we'll go to the gentleman. Okay. Well, then, there we go. I like it when people are collegial. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Andrew McDowell. I'm from the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. We have a small force of activated reservists from the Army. They're generally indistinguishable from our regular component soldiers, except they're all on 1231 or 1231 Delta. All their orders in September 30th. We use our own funding for FRA to bring them on. What can the Army do to help ensure some stability for not just the soldiers, but also our mission?
Well, you brought up a great point, the capability of the Army Reserve. Those soldiers are coming from our Military Intelligence Readiness Command, about 5,000 Army Reserve soldiers that are doing high-tech, very important and very critical intelligence gathering and support around the world. So even on a battle assembly weekend, we have soldiers, Army Reserve soldiers, that are doing intelligence assessment, that are supporting activities in the combatant command areas throughout the world. And we have a number of people, not only at the National Geospatial Agency, but JAEDO and others, that are supporting that critical mission. So I think what we can continue to do as the Army Reserve is continue to make sure those individuals are trained and that they're available to accomplish the mission. In terms of the funding piece, we're not resourced to provide additional funding that could pay their salary for a different agency, but we absolutely have the responsibility and will ensure that they have the training necessary to be successful when they are selected for one of those missions. So we think it's a win-win. For the Army Reserve, we provide, we receive a soldier back who's highly trained and has new skills. And in terms of the agencies, they get an outstanding Army Reserve soldier that can provide immediate effectiveness on the job.
Mr. Phillips.
General Donahue, recognizing the general excellence and performance of the reserve components over the last 13 or 14 years, when do you think we'll see a reserve component 3-star as the deputy commanding general of FORSCOM or TRADOC or some other 4-star command?
Are you bear baiting or what there? I don't know, Jeff. I think, you know, the chief of staff of Forces Command now is a U.S. Army Reserve major general. And I could not do my job without him. And that's out of the, you know, that came out of General Talley's largesse, because that was a slot that was, I'm actually confirmed as the deputy commanding general / chief of staff. So I'm supposed to be doing both those jobs. And thanks to General Talley, I can focus on one. So, you know, look at NORTHCOM. Pick on NORTHCOM. Maybe that's another place you look at, but I don't know. I think the time will come, and it would make sense.
Anyone else? Gentlemen at the center table, please.
Bob Norton, MOAA. All of the panel members mentioned the various call-up authorities that are available to access Army Reserve soldiers. My question concerns the provisions that are in the defense authorization that came out of the Military Compensation and Retirement Modernization Commission to essentially consolidate the orders from about 30 call-up authorities down to about 6. In the panel's opinion, will that make the accessing reserve soldiers simpler, or in the real world, will it cause other, perhaps, second and third order problems that maybe the Commission and the Armed Services Committees haven't thought about? So 30 orders down to 6, it's going to be passed. And it will be a fact in law in the very near future. Will that make it easier or more complex to use reserve soldiers?
I'll start. You know, it seems like every NDA the authorities change. Sometimes it's 1207, sometimes 1208, sometimes it's 1204. we have to be nimble and track very closely how the law changes so that we can adjust the authorities we use. So from our perspective, I think we'll be nimble enough to be able to find the authority we need to access the reserve soldier. I don't know the other implications yet of the NDA because it's still working through that you're talking about. But I think in general, we'll be able to work with what we're given because the intent of the I think, is to make it easier for us to use authorities to get the reserve component soldier. So we'll see. But in the past, as the authorities have changed, we've been nimble enough to be able to make it work.
Yeah, I would add, I'm certainly not an expert, but I would say it's going to make it simpler. I think anybody in the military has been in locations where you're sitting next to somebody who's on a different authority, and they're authorized different money. They may be authorized a joint award, and it creates friction, actually, down in the downrange environment. So any way that we can consolidate the orders process to be more synchronized and to have less, I think it's going to be very effective.
My comment, as is traditional, we're actually USDPNR, Undersecretary for Personnel and Readiness, is updating the access to the reserve component directive for the Defense Department, and scanning that pretty quickly, it looks like it accounts for only about 6 or 8 statutes. So I don't know if it's anticipation or what specifically, but hopefully it's in line with what's going to be published in the NDAA. But it's actually a very good document, and understanding the statutes, somebody like myself, who is not a PNR person, had the opportunity to read this before I came here, and it's pretty clear, so I think it's helpful. It'll be helpful for the department. It'll be helpful for all the services in that regard.
Now, if I could just weigh in briefly. Having been the policy director on the House Armed Services Committee staff, nothing is more sensitive than what that commission tackled. And the hope is that legislatively there are the necessary and sufficient authorities. But I think we all know that when authorities meet the real world, there's always some churn. And I think once legislation gets passed and implemented, it is up to all of the stakeholders to highlight, hey, this isn't working for me, or this is not working as we think you intended it to work. And staffers, my former colleagues, I think are very open to that because they understand that it's really hard to get the 100% solution first time. And so I just offer that up to you, that I understand what they're trying to do and the intent is to make it simpler. If that doesn't end up being the case, they're interested in figuring out how to fix it. And hopefully the answer isn't to create 50 new authorities. Yeah. I think this is our last question.
Franklin Childress, the Communication Director for the Army Reserve. I just want to find out from your different perspectives and your facets of you look at it, what is the single greatest capability, in your opinion, that the Army Reserve brings to the total force?
I'll start. I think it's the depth of experience, twice the citizen type approach. I'll use an example. When I was in Kandahar in 2003, that was an airfield that the Americans had built, and we heard about this thing called the Kajaki Dam, which the Americans also had built, USAID, in the 50s, but no American's probably been there for 50 years. The soldier I sent up there was a USAR E-5. Escorted by a Romanian motorized platoon or a company. And that E-5 in the USAR was a professional engineer, electrical engineer in real life. And he went up there and did the assessment of the two Westinghouse turbines that were up there, real rickety at that point. And he was the guy who briefed the ambassador on the assessment of that dam. So that's what, that depth that comes with the USAR soldier is probably the greatest capability that we get by having a USAR solution.
General Donahue took mine. No. I was going to say that, but I think another key element, a strength of the Army Reserve, is that we're resident in the communities. We're present in 1,100 different communities around the nation. We are part of the fabric of our nation, and I think that provides not only capacity to provide the needed skill sets to the Army, But I think it's important, and it was touched on earlier, that the Army remains engaged with the population. It's not good when you have a very, very small part of the population that served in the military. So I think that it's incumbent upon us and the Army Reserve and the National Guard to be part of the community and help explain what the Army does and the great benefits that it provides to the nation, and how critical that is to be a community-based force in order to enhance that.
I'll just say I'm a retired Marine, and I learn a lot every day about the different services and the different components of the services. And the Army Reserve's capabilities, CSS capabilities, are unmatched. It's just extraordinary, the capabilities they have. I also believe the civilian work experience of the Army Reserve soldiers is tremendous. And as just stated, the strong connection to the communities that are out there. But again, from my vantage point for defense support to civil authorities, it's also that geographic proximity of these enormous capabilities that we have that I think that collectively we need to continue to work on finding ways that we can tap into those for defense support to civil authorities.
Well, before I conclude this panel, I just want to ask people, we have one more speaker left, and General Talley will provide his closing remarks to wrap up our half day here. So I would ask that you be back here in the room at 11:15. But before you depart, if you would join me, please, in thanking our current panel. Thank you very much. All right. I'd like to thank everyone for sticking it out. I know these half-day sessions can be rough, but I hope that our beverage selection and our selection of food out there has kept you going and energy is high, because I think this final session is well worth paying close attention to. Our closing remarks are being offered by Lieutenant General Talley. We've heard him referenced several times, but this is the first time we're introducing him here this morning. General Talley is the senior leader for the U.S. Army Reserve, and as was mentioned before, he is both the Chief of the Army Reserve, he's the 32nd Chief of the Army Reserve, but he's also the Commanding General of U.S. Army Reserve Command. As the Chief of the Army Reserve, he is the Principal Staff Advisor to the Secretary of the Army and General Odierno on all Army Reserve affairs. He develops budgets, which we've heard a lot about today, training programs and policy decisions, and he manages the Army Reserve Troop Program Units, Individual Mobilization Augmentees, or IMAs, as we've heard talked about, and the Active Guard Reserve Program, and he serves as the Appropriation Director of all Army Reserve funds. He's got a fantastic career behind him, and I'm sure he's got a fantastic career ahead of him as well. But without further ado, I wanted to offer the floor to General Talley for his closing remarks. Sir.
So thank you, Stephanie. Appreciate everybody sticking it out. I know these things are hard, and it's tough to dedicate so many hours back-to-back for one event. We're all very busy, and we have a lot of great leaders in the room, and I want to thank Pat Donahue, who had to take off from Forces Command. What a great officer, a great general, a great leader, and a great battle buddy at Forces Command. It's certainly my privilege to talk to you on behalf of the Army Reserve. Certainly, I'm representing all the 200,000 plus soldiers and civilians of America's Army Reserve. As the Chief of the Army Reserve, I am also proud to represent and speak for General Odierno, our Chief of our total Army. I like to remind folks, he's not the Chief of Compo 1, the regular Army. He's the Chief of Staff for our total Army, Compo 1, 2, and 3, and certainly Secretary McHugh, our Secretary for the Army. And then as the CG for U.S. Army Reserve Command, I'm certainly happy to represent General Milley, who is my commanding general at Forces Command, which of course is down at Fort Bragg. I'd like to thank the Center for Strategic International Studies for sponsoring this important seminar about America's Army Reserve, and my thanks to all of those folks today that were very knowledgeable and very articulate in both as speakers and panelists for their insights and perspectives on the importance of the Army Reserve as we serve our total Army and the nation. Now, to all of those also that are attending today that aren't here, Yes, we have all of you in this room, but we have others that are participating via feed. They're getting tweets as we speak. They're probably going to listen to podcasts. I want to acknowledge them as well. I hope all of us, those here and those in virtual, will find this seminar informative and hopefully enjoyable. As I get to provide the closing remarks, I want you, if you would, allow me a few minutes to give you my perspective on a few things about our Army and also our Army Reserve. So the first is to start off, I'm a recovering academic, so I have an academic background, so I'm going to start kind of big and then maybe narrow it down. And I'm going to, the good thing about being last is I can try not to repeat or be too redundant on what's already been said. So here's the challenge we have in the United States, and it's very similar to our friends and allies. We can't afford the size of an active component that we would like to have. It's that simple. So we have to rely more on our reserve component to serve the nation and to partner with our allies. And that's pretty important because as the Chief of the Army Reserve, when I go around and meet with other nations, and I do get asked to do that, the interesting thing I find is they have the same problem. They express their problem in the same way. And then they say, you know, we've looked at the reserve components that are out there with our friends and allies. And in almost every case, they say, we're going to use the Army Reserve of the United States as the business model for our reserve component for our country. So that's a very nice compliment, right, when others want to replicate and imitate what you represent in terms of your organization. A lot's been said about what I'll call Army Reserve 101. I don't want to be too redundant, but I'll mention a few things. I think it's relevant to talk about a little bit about force structure and a little bit about history. And so I haven't heard this said today. So if it was said and I was dozing off, Dave or Pete or one of our Army Reserve folks, let me know that, and I'll move on. They can use a term called dead horse. It's a term that I use within the staff that if I get redundant and repetitive, they say the word dead horse, and then I acknowledge it, and then I move on. So recovering school teachers, so sometimes we can be redundant. So after Vietnam War, General Abrams, our Chief of Staff of the Army, said, you know, I can't change policy for the nation, but what I can do is I can change our force structure in the Army to make sure that our nation never goes to war again in a sustained combat operations, particularly land force operations, without the buy-in of the population. And the best way to do that is to make sure we have our citizen soldiers and our Army National Guard and our Army Reserve involved, because they're the direct link to the community. So we changed force structure to make it so we could never have sustained land campaign again without the total Army, active guard and reserve. Fast forward a few years into the 90s, the 32nd Chief of Staff of the Army, Gordon Sullivan, who is now president of AUSA, a great officer, great general, and a great leader for AUSA, he made a decision in the 90s to put most of the combat support and service support in the Army Reserve. So now what you have in force structure, so this is kind of Army 101, you've got three components, right? Compo 1, regular Army, predominantly combat effects formation, brigade combat teams, as it should be. They're the point of the spear. Compo 2, one of our great Army National Guards, and of course there's no such thing as the Army National Guards. There's lots of Army National Guards because it's a state force. It's a federal force, Title 32, but under state control. And it's, as I often have to explain to folks, they're a little different than the Army Reserve because they don't work for the Army. The Army National Guard doesn't work for the Army. They're a state force, and they work for, under a political appointee called the Adjutant General, they work for a governor. And then there's the reserve for the United States Army, and that's called the Army Reserve. The Guard is not the reserve for the U.S. Army. They're part of the reserves. They're part of, great part of our reserve component, but they're not the reserve. The reserve is the United States Army Reserve. And we're a federal force under federal control, and I work for the Army. Everyone in the Army Reserve works for the Army. It doesn't mean we're better, it just means we're a little bit different. So accessibility is a little easier, and as was already mentioned, we're the only component of the Army that's also a command. So the Army is not a single command, nor is Compo 2, but Compo 3, by designation of Congress and statute, is a command and a component. And that makes it a little easier for us to integrate statutory authorities with command authorities and execute effective and efficient response, whether reinforcing our Guard brothers and sisters in the defense of the homeland and elsewhere, or directly supporting Army Service Component Commands and Combatant Commands. And of course, all that is done in coordination and support through Forces Command. So that's a point I didn't hear. Another point I want to focus on Army Reserve 101 is just to recognize that we're in over 30 countries today and all 56 states and territories. We have a footprint everywhere. We are that community-based force. But let me talk about brand a little bit. I think Joe Heck, Congressman Heck, talked about brand. So our culture is different. So I wish we had the effective branding of the National Guard. You know, I wish I had a Nagus. I wish I had 54, all the governors and tags that would go out there and promote the brand. But our brand is not the Army Reserve. Our brand is the United States Army. The Army Reserve is part of the Army. And our culture is we are soldiers in the Army. And it is never about the component called Compo 3 Army Reserve. It is about the Army. We serve the Army. And so it's very difficult sometimes to find out someone's an Army Reserve soldier because they just identify themselves as an Army soldier. Now, this does not imply that the National Guard does not, but in National Guard, their culture is we're first the Guard, and then we're in the Army and Air National Guard. One is not good and one is not bad. They're just different. That's why we have three components. They complement each other. But our culture is to promote the brand called the Army, not the brand called the Army Reserve. So you could say, so I will have to tell Joe later, we're doing a pretty good job because most people don't know who the Army Reserve is. But if you get up on Congress, I would argue they're not always so sure who the other reserve components are. But they know who the Guard is because of the, political appointees or the tags. And, you know, they tend to do a pretty good job of communicating. So I'm a little jealous, but there's a reason why our brand is not the Army Reserve. It is about the Army. And sometimes I have to remind Army Reservists, we serve the Army and the nation. It's not the other way around. And that's important. The other is, I would argue, of all the services or components, we are the most directly connected to private sector. So you've heard that we're the CS and CSS. So I alluded to that in the force structure changes that were made in the 90s. So almost all of the combat support and service support, simplified technical enablers, that are not organic to a brigade combat team, which is our principal combat effects formation, are in the Army Reserve. Because the Guard is a miniature version of Big Army, so they're predominantly brigade combat teams. Now, this is a really good thing if you're in the Army Reserve and you want to be relevant and you want to have a high demand signal. It also can be challenging because it means you have to be an operational force, because the Army, doesn't matter what mission they have, contingent or combat related, cannot execute their mission without the Army Reserve, day in and day out. Because again, almost all the technical enablers are no longer in Compo 1 and they're longer in Compo 2. They're predominantly all in Compo 3. Now the good news for America is that's a great return on investment, because how do they stay sharp? Not by DOD, they stay sharp because of the private sector. And that was alluded to in one of the panels today. What keeps us technically sharp is what we do in the private sector. Now we do work in the public sector, but most of our technical enablers work in the for-profit. And remember, private sector is also not-for-profit. Sometimes people forget that. All right, and that's where most of our citizen soldiers work, and they stay very, very proficient. In fact, often when you deploy downrange or in support activities, and you're serving the active component, regardless of the service. They're pretty happy to see an Army Reserve soldier because our technical skill sets as individual soldiers, and also collective, tend to be sometimes higher than what you'd find in the active component, because that's what we do all the time in the civilian sector. And I could give you lots of examples that I've experienced over the years, whether it's at home or abroad. So when you get back to that demand signal, any given year, the historical demand for the Army Reserve is about 28,000 soldiers. So I got to provide about 28,000 soldiers on a rotational basis every year of my operational functional. So we have big operational functional part of the Army Reserve. We have a training and support part of the Army Reserve. You heard General Donahue talk about that. That's a lot when I have to provide 28,000 every year. That's to meet mission requirements around the world. The Army Reserve is directly embedded in every Army service component, command, and combatant command, to include our special operator, SOCOM, because we're a global command. So when you, I think General Convoy mentioned the support to General Brooks out there in PACOM. Well, I have a one-star command out there that's got about 5,000 forces, because I'm not tied to a state boundary. So we have, it's a little easier to access us, and it's a little easier for us to respond because we can get the benefit of both the statutory and command authorities. And so I was kidding, so I was kind of joking a little bit. I was talking to a senator, I won't mention the state, who used to be a governor of that state, and he goes, so you can help me in my state if there's a need? Who's your tag for my state, for the Army Reserve? I said, I am, sir. Well, who's the tag for the Army Reserve for the next state? That'd be me as well, sir. I'm the tag for all the states, all the territories, and the whole world. One-stop shop. And so, at a glance was mentioned before. I would encourage you, if you haven't got at a glance, so a good friend of mine just retired from the National Guard, and him and I were having lunch one day, and we were talking about the branding thing and the marketing thing, and how do I get members of Congress and their staffs, how do I get tags and governors to know how to access and how to understand the Army Reserve? At a glance was the response to that. It's been wildly well received. And Melissa Russell I see in the room, so Melissa, will kind of wave your hand a little bit. Melissa did all the heavy lifting on that, and she's working on the second version of it now. But if you turn in here, there's only one number at the bottom of every page. It's the same number. You call that number 24/7, you get a real person, imagine that, and they will answer whatever your questions. You might be General Brooks calling for command help. No problem. That's the operations center. You might be a member of Congress, no problem. One-stop shop, you only got to know two numbers, number and at a glance for anything operational anywhere around the world. Doesn't matter who you are. It's amazing. And immediate authority has already been talked to before, but I've already delegated that down all the way to the lowest level. So the Army Reserve every day responds, helping our first responders, reinforcing the success of our National Guard brothers and sisters, and we have that authority to do so. We do it all the time. But we don't necessarily do a press release on it. So we could improve in that area. Let me talk to you a little bit about global challenges. So regardless of which part of the world we're focused on, I think we all can agree that today's environment is ever increasing in complexity and that the threats to our nation are growing. At least that's my opinion. So how should we respond? So when you think of Army strategy, some of you have heard of Army strategy, right? And the way that we describe it is prevent, shape, and win. Hopefully some of you have heard of that, prevent, shape, and win. We say by executing prevent, shape, and win missions in support of our combatant commands, we can hopefully address whatever global threats there are. So again, I mentioned I was a recovering academic, so let's do a quick thought experiment. So I want you to imagine this in your head. Remember, think of the Y and X axis. So you have a graph in your head, okay? Remember the X axis and the Y axis, right? On the x-axis, horizontal, all right, you have the word instability and violence. And so at 0-0, right, that's low. And as you move to the right on the x-axis, you increase to the high range of instability and violence. On the y-axis, we have sustainability, low at the zero. And as you move up the vertical axis, the y-axis, it's high. So you're plotting sustainability versus instability and violence. And then if I were to draw two goose eggs on the graph, one that just lumps together prevent and shape, and the other that is win, remembering prevent and shape is really non-lethal operations, and win is kinetics, what we used to call kinetics, lethal operations. What you're going to visualize, hopefully, is in the upper left, where you have high sustainability and low instability and low violence, you're going to have prevent and shape. And as you move to the lower right of the graph, you're going to have what? Lethal operations win. So as the chief of the Army Reserve, my customers are combatant commands. So when I go around and talk to combatant command every year, and every year I do my annual pilgrimage to all the combatant commands, and I meet personally with the combatant commander. In every case, I ask the same question. Sir, I assume you don't want to win. And then they look at me, particularly if they're non-Army, because they may not, you know, and they'll say, what are you talking about, Tally? I said, no, wait a minute, work with me, sir, work with me. I assume you don't want to win. Oh, you mean utilize lethal operations, kinetics. That's right. I don't want to have to go to the Secretary of Defense and the Commander-in-Chief and ask to engage in lethal operations. So you want to prevent and shape in your AOR, area of responsibility, to hopefully never have to move into kinetics and lethal operations. Yep, that's exactly right. All right, sir. Tell me what that looks like. Doesn't matter, we could be talking to the PACOM commander, AFRICOM, pick your favorite combatant command. Tell me what prevent and shape looks like. Give me examples. Well, let's see, it's small teams on the ground, not a lot of visibility, less than 30 days maybe. Great if they interacted with interagency, private sector partners, academic sectors. You know, they're not VCTs, they're engineers, they're lawyers, they're logisticians. They're signal, they're medical. You mean they're combat service support, sir? Combat support? Yeah, that's what they are. They're CS and CSS, and that's what I need. That's the Army Reserve. And then you move over to, unfortunately, the other environment when you have to win, and sometimes we have to, unfortunately, conduct lethal operations, and then we want to win quick and decisively. Guess what? Combat forces can't win without the enablers. And there's the Army Reserve again. So it doesn't matter where you are on that spectrum, but as you can see, because of the force structure changes, our demand signal is increasing in the Army Reserve. So now let's go to the states. Defense of the Homeland is a NORTHCOM responsibility. Some people forget that. You know, sometimes I was mentioning this before, sometimes when I'm talking to my brothers and sisters in the Guard, I have to remind them, it's not a National Guard thing, it is a NORTHCOM thing. It is NORTHCOM commanders responsible to defend the Homeland. Now, the Guard plays an incredibly important role, but it's a Title 10 mission. And the Title 10 force is called the Army Reserve. And so when I'm talking to the NORTHCOM combatant command team in Army North, and I'm talking to our TAGs and our great National Guard that work for the governors, and I ask the governors, what do you need? I ask them the same question. I don't use the term prevent, shape, and win, but I say, what do you need in your state? And guess what they describe to me? It's the exact same description the combatant commanders. They want to do prevent and shape stuff. And they're like, I actually want and need what you've got. I don't need a BCT. And so then they're talking about how do you access the Army Reserve and how can you help support the Guard, and then I hand them a copy of at a glance and we're off. So whether we're talking at home or abroad, the demand continues to grow. And so my concern is because of Budget Control Act and sequestration, the Army Reserve, which must remain an operational force or a part of the operational force, is becoming a strategic force. Now, I don't want to give you the impression that Compo 3 is the only one that's severely affected. Our great Army, regular Army, Compo 1, Compo 2, our great National Guard, and Compo 3, the Army Reserve, are all being severely hampered in our ability to promote readiness to serve the nation and others because of Budget Control Act sequestration. And we're just going to have to be frank, find a way to deal with it. But the challenge I've got is if I don't have operational readiness in CS and CSS, the Army could fail a mission. And the Army is the only service that integrates and synchronizes across the battlefield. For all services. We're the only service that can do that. And so all the combatant commanders, most of the demand signal lies on the Army more than any other service. And so I'm concerned about that because I want to make sure I never fail to provide the support to the Secretary and the Chief that we need in service to the total force. So how do we stay ready? I'm not going to go through it in detail because I want to spend more time in Q&A, but so I told you I was recovering academics, so I would like to give you a homework assignment. If you choose to accept it. So the first, if you haven't seen at a glance, you can just Google it. I think we may have some copies available too. And at a minimum, just look at it and look what state you're from. So it has 2-page spread for every state. So the first thing everybody does is go to their state and see what do we got in there. And it tells you the economic impact on your state from the Army Reserve and what's in your state. I'd encourage you just be familiar with, so Google at a glance in PDF. And the other is, if you want to know what I think and what's important to me, it's called Rally Point 32, which I wrote when I took command a little over 3 years ago, and then recently 32.1. And this talks about my strategic priorities as the Chief of the Army Reserve and my operational tactical priorities as the CG for U.S. Army Reserve Command. And it's very important. It talks about Fort Family in here. It talks about a lot of the things that we've been talking about. But it really, 32.1 does is it showcases the two ways that we maintain readiness, regardless of whether doing missions at home or abroad. And I'm just going to mention those. I won't go into details because I'd rather get into Q&A. And I think Dave Convoy mentioned one of these. The first is, how do we generate readiness using a government approach? And that's called plan, prepare, provide. Planning means we have the Army Reserve, again, embedded everywhere, and so they're doing critical staff planning, and we have these new organizations called Army Reserve Engagement Cells and Teams embedded in every Corps, Army Corps, every Army Service Component Command, and every Combatant Command, to include our special operators. And they're doing that planning, they're trying to find money, all the things that General Convoy mentioned. And then we have our prepare part of that, which is really total Army, total force training, as we're preparing to do some sort of mission. And then the provide is when we're actually providing an Army Reserve asset to meet a mission requirement worldwide. And it could be a soldier, a leader, or a unit. And that's plan, prepare, provide. And that's our business model on how we generate readiness. And it works really, really well. So I have an advantage. It's a lot harder for Compo 1 and Compo 2 to get combat effects formations out the door. It doesn't matter what component you're in. A BCT and combat effects formations just take a lot longer to get them trained up and ready. But you know what? It doesn't take a lot of effort for me to get a bunch of lawyers to go out the door. And believe it or not, my demand signal for lawyers is really high. No one mentioned lawyers earlier. 94% of all the legal units in the Army are in the Army Reserve. Now, that's a good thing. Some of the people tell me that's a bad thing. But my point is, big demand signal. So lawyers, engineers, technical people, yes, we go to a MOB site, but generally it's a very, very short period of time, normally just to validate what we've already done, because they're doing their technical enabling capability in uniform. It's just easier for us to get them out the door. The other way that we generate readiness, which I'll show you a very short video on, is through private-public partnership. So my predecessor, Jack Stoltz, created the Employers Partnership Program, which became so well-received, it was replicated across all of the Department of Defense, eventually became known as Heroes to Hire. So outside of academia, in academia, plagiarism's bad, but outside of academia, plagiarism is the nicest form of flattery. And so Jack Stoltz did a great job with that. When I came into office, I wanted to take that private-public, I wanted to take it to the next level, so I renamed it Private-Public Partnership. And the idea is, how can we leverage the almost 7,000 agreements we have in place with private sector, from startups to Fortune 100s, how do we leverage that so they can help us generate higher levels of readiness at the individual, leader, staff, and unit level from a private sector approach? I'll just give you just a couple quick examples, and then I'll end that discussion. So individual readiness. Financial readiness is very important. And so I recognize the audience I'm with, and I recognize it's probably being broadcast. So our soldiers have the same problem our Congress does. They spend more money than they can take in, and that's a challenge for our Congress. And I trust our congressional leaders are working hard on that, and they recognize it as a challenge. Our soldiers are the same way. So financial readiness is critical to the nation. In fact, going back to Admiral Mullins, the former chief of staff or chairman of Joint Chiefs, said the biggest threat to the United States and our military force is the deficit. Nobody talks about that anymore. All right, I'm not trying to be political. I'm just saying it's the same problem with individual readiness. If soldiers have a financial readiness issue, it's very difficult for them to do what we need them to do. So we partner with people for like Dave Ramsey on one side and Susie Orman on the other to help partner and share their benefits of their companies and their financial advice to help, at no expense to the Army Reserve, promote financial readiness. And we're working with various banks and stuff where they basically leverage and donate their services. We do the same thing with Tony Horton, if you're familiar with P90X. And I'm not promoting any of these products. We have 7,000 private sector partners. We don't endorse any of them. But what we do is find a way to partner with them on projects where it's good for them and it's good for generating readiness, whether we're talking physical fitness, financial readiness, academia, and I could give you lots of examples. It's been very, very successful. In fact, the Department of Defense has recently launched their own private-public partnership modeled after the Army Reserve. Again, a very nice complement to the Army Reserve. It's very powerful. Now, why do I say that? Because I believe the challenges of the world can't be solved by governments alone. It's going to take governments and the private sector. And the Army Reserve, because we're so uniquely positioned in the private sector as citizen soldiers, we need to be leading that connectivity for our military and perhaps for our broader federal government. And that's what we're doing. And we're receiving a lot of accolades on both sides of the fence, whether it's from the government side or the private sector side. So that private-public partnership is important. Also, what it does is, of course, provides career opportunities for our soldiers, whether they're coming out of the active component, transitioning into the Army Reserve or Guard or elsewhere. So what I tell our Army Reserve soldiers and civilians everywhere I go is focus first and foremost on your family. Focus second on your community, and focus third on your civilian employer. And blow off the Army part. Well, that's heresy. You can't say that. You're a general in the Army. You can't say that. I do say that. I've been saying it over 3 years, and they haven't fired me yet. Of course, there's still a few more months to go, but they could get rid of me. Now, why do I say that? Because as a citizen soldier, if you focus on your family, your community, be a leader in your family, a leader in your community, and a leader in your civilian employment, I don't need to worry about the soldier part. I guarantee you I got a better soldier. And I've got a soldier for life. Because if you get those three out of balance, you're not going to stay a soldier for life. And you're not going to be able to leverage the types of skill sets we heard up here earlier to really benefit and lead the nation the way that our citizens expect. So I guess what I want to do is wrap up with one final comments, and then I'll show you a quick P3O video, and then we'll get into Q&A. So today, as we see increasing volatile global security environment unfolding before us, we got to recognize that nations can't afford to regress to a one-dimensional strategic reserve force with a tiered readiness. We've got to sustain an operational force, and that includes all three components, certainly Compo 1, but also, I'd argue, in Compo 2, our great Army National Guard, and Compo 3, the Army Reserve. In closing, I think when you look at the Army Reserve, it's a great return on America. 5.9% of the budget, almost 20% of the force. And again, most of the technical enabling capability comes at no expense to the DOD. We are a life-saving, life-sustaining force for the nation. That's what we do as technical enablers. We save lives and we sustain lives. And you just need to know that the Army Reserve has never failed a mission. And we've always been there for the United States, and we always will. My thanks to CSIS for hosting this discussion. I look forward after the video to your questions, and I hope each of you always remembers to stay Army strong. Roll it. The Army Reserve has provided cutting-edge civilian and industry-based expertise to the force for more than a century. But today's complex and growing security challenges can't be solved by governments alone. It's going to take governments and the private sector. The Army Reserve's private-public partnership, or as we like to refer to it, P3I, allows industry leaders to leverage the civilian capabilities and military leadership of our citizen soldiers. Startup companies to Fortune 100 companies partner with the Army Reserve and hire our citizen soldiers because they make great employees. The thought is, how do we work together, government and the private sector, to create a program that really allows us to help those companies and at the same time help improve the readiness of our soldiers, leaders, and units in the Army Reserve?
Kenai Drilling is one of the largest privately owned drilling contractors in the United States. You know, everyone goes, why do you hire Army Reserve soldiers? And really you want to say, well, because everybody loves soldiers. We hire soldiers because we owe them and there's a great service. And that's true, completely true. However, it's kind of selfish too. Any employer wants good people, and the Army Reserve provides that. They bring both soft skills, they bring hard skills, they have the ability to identify hazards, they have leadership qualities that are just exceptional in comparison to civilian counterparts.
Well, this is a unique environment in that there are extremely short turnaround periods. You need to be decisive about the decisions that you make. You need to be confident that decisions you make are good ones. The soldiers that we've had here are able to do all of those things and more. They have a confidence that really helps them thrive here.
What the military has taught me was discipline, being prepared, you know, really looking at a problem and trying to find out how to solve that problem. And all of those skills come into play when you work for any company.
In my line of work, everything must be very exact. A commercial has to air when it's supposed to air. And we have to be on time, we have to be off on time. Army Reserve soldiers, like any military command, have that discipline. The people I've met throughout the military, and the Army especially, are so well educated and so prepared and so so on top of their game. It's really impressive to see the people that are leading our military today.
I learned core leadership skills being an officer, and you want that type of employee to be in your business to help it grow and flourish and to work more efficiently.
For anyone that's looking for mission accomplishment with resilience, with values, with discipline, and with a ton of technical skills, I don't see why they wouldn't go to the Army and tap the reserve, help develop them, and reintegrate that back on the society after their missions. So when you talk about win-win, here it is.
Private sector helps us to be better soldiers, while we help them to succeed by sharing the skills and experiences we've learned for more than a century. Here's an excellent opportunity to help your Army Reserve develop solutions to some of our nation's greatest challenges.
Sir, we are up to your schedule, really. So why don't we go ahead and take a few questions from the audience, if you wouldn't mind returning to the podium, sir. And if we could take some questions.
People often find themselves in need of storage and moving, but don't want the hassle and...
Thanks.
We certainly don't want the hassle.
This gentleman here, please.
So who's up first?
Sir Bob Fiedler with ROA. You mentioned the spectro sequestration. How will that affect the USAR for FY16 and beyond if it kicks in, especially with your integration efforts with the active component?
So as I mentioned, Budget Control Act sequestration, it's kind of interesting when you think about it. You know, I know both parties wrote the bill to make it so draconian that it would never be passed into law, and then the rest of the story, so it is kind of interesting. And it's severely affecting. So when we look at all three components, it really depends on how far we go, but if BCA, Budget Control Act, stays into effect as it currently looks like it will, because it is our law, I'm being directed to go down from force structure right now and in strength, down from 202 to 195, but if BCA stays in effect, I could go as low as 185. Now, all the studies that are out there that have been done have showed that if you take the Army Reserve down to 185, it will present significant risk for the Army Reserve's ability in terms of not having enough force structure to provide that CSCSS piece I mentioned. Apart from the force structure in strength issue is op-tempo money. The challenge I've got is in order to maintain part of the operating force, I've got to have more than the statutory funding we get from Congress, which is 39 training days a year, 2 weeks of AT, annual training, plus 48 battle assemblies, which is really, when you add it all up, that's the 39 training days. So I need additional op-tempo money that comes from the Army in order to generate a higher level of readiness so we can, in fact, execute some of the missions that we've been talking about today. Budget Control Act jeopardizes us having that, and I would argue the Army Reserve right now, and I've said this in testimony, is becoming a strategic reserve. Not so much because of the end strength we're currently at and being directed to go to, but because of lack of money to do both equipping, modernization, training. And that's the real challenge. And so we will become a strategic force. We're slowly becoming a strategic force. And the chief, we just had an offsite with the CSA and the senior Army leaders for the last couple days at this offsite location, and this issue came up. We can't afford for all of the Army Reserve to become strategic. So how do we in the Army find a way to prevent that from happening, recognizing that the Army's got a huge bill and was hit the hardest of all the services in terms of downsizing? And right now, I will tell you, we're struggling with how to find a solution. In essence, we have a cash flow problem. So I don't have a clear, but the impact is significant. Bob, did I answer your question? Okay.
Anyone else?
Yes, sir.
So I just finished reading Partners in Command, and at the end of Partners in Command, it's General Marshall and General Eisenhower looking at what the aspirations they had for the Army post the end of World War II. So your tenure as the car is going to end, may end, I'll say may, you never know with the Army.
June 4th, 9 o'clock in the morning.
May end.
But I'm not counting.
So as you depart, you know, just like Eisenhower did, so Eisenhower had two aspirations for the Army. One aspiration was an all-volunteer force, which was achieved. The other aspiration was not to have to have a better training platform for the Army, which he did not achieve and was not achieved as seen through history. So what two aspirations would you have for the Army, and I won't say for the Army Reserve, for the Army, from your foxhole as the car and from the commander of the United States Army Reserve?
Well, I mean, the good news is the Army gets it. I mean, you remember, I work for the Secretary McHugh and General O, and I have no access problem to the Secretary of the Chief. And, you know, I get paid to tell them what they need to hear, even if sometimes they don't like the message. But I will say, and now, again, 3 years, 3 months, give or take, I've never had a message that I've communicated to the Chief or the Secretary been pushed off, not heard, just the opposite. I mean, there are some times where I've had to tell the Chief, sir, we're testifying together, and this is what I'm going to say, and this is the direction I've got to go on this issue, and it may be uncomfortable because I report to the Congress in terms of the posture of the Army Reserve. Now, it goes through the Army, but it's the Army Reserve posture statement. And in every case, the Chief has said, you got to do what you have to do, Jeff. Thanks for being a professional and telling me how we, I wouldn't say we have a difference, but tell me what issues you're going to present. So the good news is the Army gets it and understands the issue. I think what I would maybe, if I could, change the question just a little bit, if with your permission, is what are the two biggest things that I think we've been able to do in the Army Reserve over the last 3 years with the support of the Army and the total force? And I would argue it's plan, prepare, provide, and private-public partnership, because those two things are changing tremendously how we support the Army and the total force. And at a time where you do more with less, which I think is stupid, you do less with less, what we've been able to do is leverage and recognize the contribution partners make, and we've really been able to demonstrate that. And the Army has recognized that. So, you know, what I like the Army to do, I'd like them to palm for more 12304B money. Now, it's not money for the Army Reserve, but the Army Reserve can get access to that. I'd like them to palm for more 12304B money. They're doing that, and they're forecast to do more of that as we advance in multiple palms. I'd like them to approve our equipping modernization. They're doing that, okay? I'd like them to recognize the unique role we play in CS and CSS and acknowledge that we have to keep a certain part of our force operational. They're doing that. But the challenge you've got is it's very complicated on how you get the funding, because I have appropriations funding that the Army doesn't have, but my challenge is really what we call op-tempo money. And so I've got the same problem that active duty units got. They don't have enough op-tempo money to keep their readiness. So the Chief is having a problem keeping his active component BCTs ready, and they have to be ready. The question is, how do you take some of that money and divert it over to the Army Reserve to make sure that a element of my CS and CSS is available? So I think we're in complete agreement on all the issues, the Chief and the Secretary. The real long pole in the tent, is, as we say in the Army, is the how. We know the what. We haven't figured out the how, and that's where we're struggling. And the good news is the hardest part, you recognize a problem, right? That's always the toughest part. Once you recognize and agree on a problem in an organization, that's the tough part. Now we got to figure out how we're going to implement something to change the course that we're headed. And I think the Congress has a role to play here, and also I think the Commission for the Future in the Army has a role to play, and we're seeing good support from them. So that may not be a specific answer to your question. And you don't have to let me off the hook if you don't want to.
Okay. All right. We have time for one or two more questions, so anyone from the floor? One question I have, sir, is you just mentioned the Commission on the Future of the Army. And I do know that commissions are never popular off of the Hill. There is a lot of work that needs to happen to support the commission. The commission has a very tight timeline. It stood up a little bit late, and its final report is due in February.
As we all know, that means the drafting has to be done in December for it to go through what it needs to go through. So what would you like to see out of the report from a reserve perspective? I do know that they just visited Fort Hood last week, but what would you like them to see? What in the field would you like to hold up as an example of listen, commissioners, this is what we're doing very well, and in all of your recommendations, you have a lot to improve, but there are certain things you shouldn't break. What shouldn't they break?
That's a great question. Thank you. So if you really want to know the answer to this question in detail, I've provided written statements, two different written statements to the commission, and those are public documents, and those are available. I'd encourage you to take a look at them. And I've met with the commission twice personally, once as the chief of the Army Reserve in the Pentagon, and the other as the commander of U.S. Army Reserve Command at Fort Bragg. And so I'll just tick off a couple of them. But if you go to the documents I've just mentioned, they're about 15 pages, give or take each. You don't have to read them all, because what I've done is on the first page, I've said recommended, I put the recommendations for, I made it easy. I just want them to cut and paste and stick it in there. You got to make it easy. I used to be in academia, right? So I list out very specific the recommendations from a component level and from a command level. And so you only have to get through the first page to get those. So I'd encourage you to look at them. But the first one is to recognize the value of all three components of our Army, and it works, and don't mess with it. There's a lot of dialogue or discussion out there on the streets about the Guard taking over the Army Reserve or the Army Reserve taking over the Guard. There's a reason we have three components. They each have a very distinct role. The Army Reserve complements the regular Army. We are the Title 10 force. We are the reserve for the Army. It works. The State Force, which is our National Guards, it works. So recognize the goodness and the value of how all three components working together really does provide a tremendous capability as a total Army. That's the first one. The second is to recognize some of the points I made here before, and that is the Army Reserve is different. You have to keep us operational because of that CSCSS force structure point I made. I say it a little bit differently, but that's the bottom line. And the third point is to recognize that as we generate readiness in our formations, it's all about full-time support. So if you have a business and your business model is only 13% is full-time people and the rest is part-time, my guess is, and you went to investors, they probably say, well, I'm not so sure your business model is a good business model. That's the Army Reserve. Our full-time support, full-time people, is 13%, the lowest of any reserve component, any service. And yet we're the biggest three-star command in the DOD, the second largest command in the Army. Force Comm is the only one that's bigger, and that's because we're part of Force Comm. Okay? The Army Reserve is as big as all the other Federal Reserve combined. And yet the average for full-time support for the RC is 19.4%, and I'm 13. I just said I'm the biggest, the most complex, blah, 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 blah. What up? Doesn't make any sense. So I'm not resourced at 100% of my full-time manning. Currently resourced at 76% of the required number of full-time support. And I've already said that equates to 13% of the total number. I need more full-time support. There's pressures out there to cut my full-time support. Why? If you have a cash flow problem, you don't cut the part-time employees, you go after the full-time employees, right? But if you're only at 13% and you cut your full-time employees, you have to close the company because there's no longer anybody to process pay, do all the basic stuff. So the FTS is critical. So what I've suggested to the Army is the Army probably doesn't feel comfortable going to Congress and supporting me to increase above 76% FTS, which are AGRs and military technicians and great Department of Army civilians. So I said, okay, let's do this. Let's go to 85%, which would bring me from what we call a P4 in the USR to a P2 in terms of full-time manning, but make the 76 to 85%, the bump up, be regular Army officers and NCOs who are in Army Reserve units, reinforcing total Army force policy. And I thought tell the Congress, you can't take the regular Army down as far as you'd like because you need to keep a higher number in the regular Army for another reason, for title, what we call Title 11 integration into the Guard and Reserve. By the way, the National Guard loves this idea too. The Army's not adverse to it. So full-time manning is critical. So I'll just stop there. You can get the reports and read in more detail.
Well, thank you, sir, for both your comprehensive remarks, the video, and then your candid responses to the questions. And also for, to be honest, it was General Talley and his office that conceptualized today's event, and I'm grateful for that because, as I mentioned earlier, we get a lot of airtime for the regular Army and the National Guard, in no small part because of Naugus and other advocates out there, that the reserve sometimes just falls through the cracks. And I think here at CSIS, we are committed to stopping that to the extent that we can, and to raise issues that are important not just for the total Army, but for the reserve in particular, and getting their voice heard a little bit more around this town. So please join me in thanking General Talley both for his participation and his concept. So thank you.